I'm Pastor Gretchen Hope Wilson, pastor at Green Mountain Presbyterian Church in Lakewood, Colorado. We are so pleased that you are joining us on this Sunday, October 11th of 2020, for this recorded worship service. In our community this day, we are remembering animals that grace our lives. We will participate together on this Sunday morning at 10 a.m. in our prayer Zoom fellowship time with a blessing of the animals that grace our lives. And so we're so pleased that you are joining us. Maybe you found us on our church website at www.gmpc.net, and that took you to our YouTube channel at Green Mountain Presbyterian Church, Lakewood, Colorado. But know that we are grateful that you are with us in worship this day. In this month of October, we are in the midst of a series called Joyful, Joyful, and we are dwelling together in Paul's letter to the church at Philippi in the little book of Philippians at the end of the New Testament. And so we look forward to being with you in God's word, and we pray God's rich blessings upon you and those that are dear to your heart this day. May God be with you as we worship our wondrous God.
Good morning, everyone, or evening, depending on when you're watching with us today. We're glad to have you with us. Let us call each other to worship in spirit and heart, for we're all together on this earth, so we are calling each other to worship no matter what time we watch this. We believe that God formed all the creatures on this earth, and God saw that it was good. We believe that every creature that borrows life from you is always in your care. Help us to join you in caring for the animals that walk this earth, swim our lakes and seas, and soar through our skies.
God, your creatures fill the earth with wonder and delight, and every living thing has worth and beauty in your sight. So playful dolphins dance and swim, your sheep fade down and graze, your songbirds share morning hymn to offer you their praise. You made the pets we welcome in their wondrous blessings too, with paws and whiskers, wings and fins, they offer praise to you. Oh Lord, you call us to embrace these creatures in our care. May we show kindness, love, and grace to all pets everywhere. You made the creatures on each farm, you know the things they need. May they grow healthy, safe from harm, and safe from human greed. Just as a shepherd loves the sheep, you know their joy, their pain. Lord, bless the animals we keep, may all farms be humane. Your creatures live in every land, they fill the sky and sea. O Lord, you give us your command to love them tenderly. We're called to have dominion near, to care for them always. By loving creatures you hold dear, we offer you our praise.
Let us join now in our unison prayer of confession and reconnection. On this particular Sunday, we remember the gift of creatures who surf our seas and swim our deeps. We celebrate those who roam our plains and climb our peaks. We honor those who soar our skies and nest in our heights. We remember the varied forms of animal life which grace this earth, and we give thanks for them. On this day, we give thanks for furry friends who fill our homes with laughter and love, feathered companions who sing melodious songs, and crawling creatures who ground us to this earth. We think of them and we give praise to you, O God, for your colorful artistic palette and vast creativity. As we ponder the gifts of creation this day, and especially the creatures you made, we are mindful that you honored us, O God, with caring for them. Forgive us when we have been more interested in our own gain and comfort at the expense of their habitats and well-being. Help us to invest ourselves and our resources in initiatives which promote the welfare of all living, breathing beings on this earth. Amen. Let's take a moment for silent prayers. Lord, please help us to remember the comfort of all the varied wildlife that you gave us. Even the creepy crawlies that some of us don't like have a purpose here. Help us to protect that purpose and remember that everything we do has a consequence. Help us to be mindful of that and come up with great ways to protect everything that you have created. Amen.
All God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing high. Some sing out loud on the telephone wire, and some just
Unison scripture reading today is Philippians 4, 4 through 7, and we will read it together. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
We will go out with joy in the Spirit. We will go out with God. We will go out with joy in the Spirit. We will go out with God. Alleluia. We will go out with joy. Alleluia. Alleluia. We will go out with joy in the Spirit. We will go out with God.
We continue this morning in our joyful, joyful series in the letter to the church at Philippi from the Apostle Paul in Philippians, the second chapter, verses 1 through 13. Our sermon today is entitled Joy in Humility, Our Animal Teachers. We want to this day, as we think about animals that are part of our lives, as we bless animals together this day, to think about the various ways that animals are our teachers. And so join with me then as we gather around the second chapter of this little letter, reading verses 1 through 13. Paul says this: if then there is any encouragement in Christ, any consolation from love, any sharing in the Spirit, any compassion and sympathy, make my joy complete. Be of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility regard others as better than yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but rather emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, and being born in human likeness, and being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, my beloved, just as you have always obeyed me, not only in my presence, but much more now in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who is at work in you, enabling you both to will and to work for his good pleasure. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Our gracious God, we give you praise and thanks for the gifts of Holy Scripture this day. We pray that you would be with us as we gather around your word, as we gather around these words to those who were first converts in Philippi. We pray that you would help us, that you would help us to see how we might apply the things that we have heard this day to our lives. We ask this in your holy and in your gracious name, and all God's people say, Amen. I can remember so joyfully when I was first ordained and began to serve the first church that I was called to serve as an ordained minister. I already knew this church pretty well because I had been a Christian educator there, but I was so thrilled to be moving into this new role with them as pastor. Now, it probably seems like a long time ago now, but back in the late 80s and early 90s, many Presbyterian churches were adding the passing of the peace liturgy into the worship service. Now, sidebar for just a moment, I have to say that in these days when we are worshiping remotely, it's one of those sadnesses for me right now, because sharing the peace with all of you was such an important and moving part of our worship time when we were together in person. And I know, of course, as you do, that such things as sharing the peace will probably not look the same when the day comes that we get to worship together in person. But go back with me now to that time period in my first call and that church that I served when they were first instituting the passing of the peace. It may seem odd to us, but it created quite a stir in that congregation. A handful of people wrote letters in opposition to the passing of the peace to the elders of the church. Others refused to participate during the service itself when the passing of the peace was happening. And there was one notable figure who would even cross her arms and pout throughout the entire time period that we were passing the peace. And this tension about this ritual went on for quite a while in that congregation. There were comments and criticisms and even divisions regarding this simple, what I think of as gracious ritual. I have my theories about why this was such an issue, but that's for another time. And I likely only have a portion of the truth about that anyway. But more importantly, I remember the stress that caused in the church, that disunity, and how painful it was. As you likely know, in the midst of this series that we are a part of right now in October called Joyful, Joyful, we are dwelling in Paul's letter to the church at Philippi in the little letter known as Philippians. And Paul wrote this letter while he was in prison to a community that was dear to his heart. In fact, scholars tell us that it was the first Christian community that the Apostle Paul founded. So, of course, he had a special fondness for them. They were the source of great joy for him. And like that early church in my history, this church that was Paul's first church, they held a special place in his heart. And so he was very discouraged by whatever news had reached him about them, that they were at odds with each other, that there was disunity in their community, and Paul wanted to address it. You can hear it, can't you? That concern about whatever discord there was in this community. In words today in our passage, make my joy complete, be of the same mind, having the same love, being of full accord and of one mind. You can feel that Paul was addressing the fact that news had reached them that they were not of full accord and not of one mind. Now, Philippi was a brilliant choice for the planting of his first church. As that phrase goes, location, location, location. Philippi was that, located on the northeastern shore of what we think of as Greece. It was a gateway between Europe and Asia on the well-developed road that you've probably heard of from that time called the Via Ignatia. It was a key Roman colony, so no wonder Paul planted a church there. He wanted them to be a bright light for Christ on this well-traveled pathway connecting much of the known world at that time. And yet, they were at odds with each other. I think he was concerned about what kind of witness they were, in part because of this. And like much of the known world at that time, they were under Roman rule. And there was this division then between those who were Roman citizens and everyone else. Roman citizens had power and position and freedom and privilege. Now, some scholars tell us that probably many of the early converts that were a part of the Philippian church were Greeks who had some means and connections, which would explain why they were able to support Paul financially during his imprisonment as well as his travels. But that there were likely also within the community those who were Roman citizens who even had more status and power. Was this a source of tension in their community life? We wonder and we suspect that such could have been the case. We certainly know, don't we, in our own nation, that the tensions that come when those with a privileged status create systems or benefit from them to the detriment of others. Over time, there are numerous inequalities. It seems like some of these same tensions were present for members in that first church in Philippi. Philippi was a diverse environment politically, religiously, economically, and culturally. So surely this made for various challenges among them as well. So Paul writes to this beloved community, knowing all the challenges they face in the very place where they reside. And in his absence, he wanted to encourage their presence, to be present to each other in ways that promoted community and unity. And to that end, he offered the example of Jesus the Christ, repeating for them the hymn, H-Y-M-N, the hymn or song of the early church, which expounded the journey that Jesus took to be with us and the example that he set for us in his life and in his death. It was meant to strike a chord within them. Quite literally, Paul wanted it to resonate in their minds and their hearts and their souls and their very selves. He wanted it to elevate and encourage them in their actions in Christian community. Yes, this Christ hymn, as some call it, offers remarkable theology about Jesus. But in this case, I think it was intended to be more inspirational than educational. We Presbyterians are good with our heads, but in this instance, we do well to let our hearts sing as we hear these words that Paul sings out from this early Christ hymn, these poetic, compassionate, caring, humble words. Though he was in the form of God, he did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave and being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name. And on it goes. To this end, Paul lifts up the example of Christ and his humility. Paul says that Jesus humbled himself and came to earth and took the form of a servant. In Greek, tapainao, that word for humbled, has a sense of reducing one's circumstances or being assigned a lower rank. This is what Jesus did when he left the heavenly realm and came to dwell with us here on earth. It's interesting to me that this word in our English language that we have, humility, comes to us from humus, the Latin root. And I think that word, H-U-M-U-S, humus, can help us to unpack what humility is all about. So if you'll hold that word with me, maybe even write it down on a piece of paper, H-U-M-U-S, that Latin root for our word humility, humus, meaning of the earth or the ground. Let's unpack what it means then to have humility. I think the H in that word can tell us to be here. If we think of H in humus, think of here, be present, here and now. Then we come to the U and the M in humus. Think of you and me. And then at the end of that little word, we get US or us. So be here and now. Think about you and me, that we might be an us. So let's unpack that a little bit more. Humus, this Latin root that means of the ground or earth. It means that to be humble, we remember that we are ground creatures, that we are of this earth. To remember that we are of dust. We are creatures created of the substance of this earth. And I think then it also has something to do with being grounded where you are, being here and now, the H of that humus. When Jesus left the glory of the heavenly realm, he came to earth to be an earth creature. And in so doing, he told us with the very gift of his presence that there is value in being of this earth and dwelling upon it. And friends, this is really significant when you think about the Greco-Roman context of Philippi. Archaeological evidence suggests that it was a very advanced city, library, ruins, a theater, significant architectural buildings, and other cultural amenities. But there were also assorted Greco-Roman gods that were worshipped there, with ornate temples built in their honor. And there was this plurality of religious life in Philippi. But it's important to remember that there was this division between earth dwellers like you and me and the Greco-Roman gods. A Zeus or a Jupiter might come to earth for a short period of time to mess with humans or human affairs, but would not dwell here. That would have been beneath them. But Jesus humbled himself, the Apostle Paul reminds us, and became one of us, an earth dweller, one grounded on the humus, on the soil, on the earth. This is immensely significant when we think about the Philippian context. And so that H of that word humus reminds us of the importance of being an earth creature and dwelling on this earth and being here and now where we find ourselves. As I've been pondering that in this week when we bless animals that are a part of our lives, I've been thinking about how animals are our teachers in so many things, including humility. These ones that we may have thought of as lower down in the created order actually have much to teach us about things of higher value. They are earthbound. They live more present on this earth in each moment. They live in an awareness of where they are and what is happening around them. They do this on just this instinctual level. And granted, we know that there are some moments that we maybe don't like to think about in the animal world that involve hunting for survival and being hunted, but they do teach us about being here and now on this earth. I know for myself, I can get lost in my head or my emotions or thoughts or experiences, and at times be unaware of the present moment or situation. And as you know, numerous spiritual teachings are focused on helping us get grounded again in this place or situation where we find ourselves and being in any given moment truly present. We seem to need to relearn how to be present. I think we maybe had it more readily when we were children, but somehow along the way, we lost some of that. But our animal teachers seem to retain this gift. They teach us humility in this way and being grounded to this earth in the present moment. I think about my childhood dog, a dachshund named Snitsy. And growing up as a latchkey kid, I never felt like I came home to an empty house because Snitsy was always there, waddling to meet me at the door, ready to cuddle and hear about my day. And in that moment, all that mattered to Snitsy was reconnecting with me, being with me. He was an earth creature present at that moment in time. Mother Michelle, our dear priest friend from St. Joseph's Episcopal Church at our neighboring church down the road from Green Mountain Presbyterian Church, tells me that even her big black cat Truffles, who was abused before they rescued her, always seems to know if she's sick. And in such moments, this one that will often avoid touch will snuggle up next to Mother Michelle and refuse to leave until she can tell that she is well again. Humus, being creatures of the earth, let the H remind us to live in the here and now like our animal teachers show us. I think another aspect of being a ground creature, being humble and of this earth, is knowing who you are and who you are not, and celebrating what you bring to the party at the same time enjoying what others have to offer and what they bring to the party as well. In our word humus, that's the you and the me that are right there in the middle of it, the you and the M, the you and the me. And it's that balance point in each of our lives where we find that place where we're not self-effacing to the point of ignoring the strengths that God has given us, nor are we overly confident and puffed up, but there's this place where we balance and we become aware of our strengths and what we have to offer, and we bring those into the world to share with others and with other of God's creatures. And at the very same time, we're aware that our other brothers and sisters and our animal teachers bring other gifts to us. And so there's this balance there of you and me, that together we become an us, creatures together bound to this earth. And there's something about this making room for others and acknowledging that we don't have all the answers and that we need each other, while at the time saying, I also have something to bring to the party. I think this is something of what Paul was talking about with the Philippians, to celebrate community, the you and the me and the us and what each of us brings to our life together. He said it this way, do nothing from selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. And Paul reminds us that Christ exemplified this looking to the interests of others while bringing your gifts to the community as well. I can remember when a friend of mine's son, who I'll call Kenny, was about 7 or 8 years old. Now, even as an infant, you could tell that Kenny had something that was physiologically off with his wiring. At times, just to touch him seemed painful to him. And as he gained in years, he had numerous sensory challenges. On one occasion, I was invited out to the riding school to watch him ride. He was enrolled in a horse therapy program. And I'm not sure how many hands tall old Midge the mare was, but she seemed quite tall to me. This beautiful horse with her chestnut coloring and the easiest laid back disposition. Kenny looked so small on her back that at first I was quite worried when I saw them lift him up on top of her. And then he began to show me how he could ride around the corral, including a little trot. Not only did he hold the reins in this expert fashion, he was learning to use his body to give Midge signals about turns and stops. She noticed every time he tightened a muscle here or there. Midge, the chestnut mare, was teaching Kenny to be aware of his body, and he learned to read hers. It was a wonder to watch. Midge, the chestnut mare, has always been an example to me of using your gifts and not shrinking back from them, and at the same time being aware of the interests and needs of others. She's an example to me of humility in this way that we are talking about, of the you and the me and the us together. So friends, who have been your animal teachers? And what have they taught you about being of this earth, about being an earth creature present in this moment, right here, right now? What have you learned from them about using the gifts that God has given you, while also enjoying the gifts that you see in others? What have they taught you about you and me and us, and that we're all in this together? What gifts have graced your life because of the animals that have walked on this earth with you? I believe this Sunday, this day, as we bless animals and as we give thanks to God for the gift that they are in our lives, we do well to remember that those that have often been considered truly humble, as in lower of status, have much to teach us about the true gift of humility, of humus, of being of this earth. May we let them teach us, that we in turn may be more Christ-like, that we in turn may offer gifts into this world that lead others back to our gracious God. May it be so. Alleluia. Amen. invite you now to join your hearts with mine in a time of prayer. Let us pray. God, in the beginning, you created all that is, things we see and things that go unnoticed to the naked eye. Out of your artistic, vast, colorful vision, you made all the creatures of this great earth, those that walk, run, crawl, fly, soar, wade, or swim, and you pronounced them good. On this Sunday, when we seek to give thanks for and bless the animals that have graced our lives, we pause now to name special creatures to you. Especially this day, we remember pets who are no longer here with us, and we name them to you, giving thanks for them. We remember pets that now grace our homes or the homes of those dear to us, and we name them before you, smiling as we think of the things they do or don't do. For the gifts of these creatures in our homes, in our yards, our neighborhoods, or on our land, we give you thanks. When we venture into the vast world you made, from the billowing seas to the rocky peaks, from the placid lakes to the expansive plains, from the lush meadows to the sandy shores, from the rolling hills to the heated deserts, we see the immense diversity of your creativity, O God. We stand in awe of the awkward aardvark and in wonder at the winged albatross. We shake our heads at the striped zebra and the cow-like zebu. From A to Z, majestic God, you have covered this world with wondrous beings. Hear us now as we name before you an animal who graces this earth that holds a special place in our hearts. We know that just as many human beings are suffering on this earth from natural disasters and fires or man-made causes, we remind ourselves that as we suffer, so do all your creatures. Storms and fires disrupt their habitats, wreak havoc on their food sources, damage their lungs, and jeopardize their futures just as they do ours. Changes in our climate impact their environments often in such drastic ways that numerous animals are unable to adapt. Whether we image polar bears on melting ice caps or insects already extinct in land that once held lush rainforests, we know that our consumption has impacted not only their habitats, but literally their very existence. Help us then, merciful God, to live in ways which honor all your creatures. May we humbly bow before you like the praying mantis who might grace our window ledge. May we remember that we are among many others, human, furred, feathered, scaled, and winged. Help us to live here and now in ways that honor them this day and in the days to come. We ask all of this in the powerful name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us when we pray together to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Each little flower that opens, each little
as we are now in the middle of the month of October, invite you to check your Connections newsletter to see who has a birthday this month, that you might reach out to them with your good thoughts and wishes. Again, deep appreciation to those who continue to support Green Mountain Presbyterian Church financially. You are making an incredible difference during these coronavirus days and keeping us strong and vital and integrally involved in our community. Know we appreciate you. There are a variety of announcements to highlight for you. As always, we encourage you to check your Connections newsletter to see all the things that are happening in the life of the church. If you are not getting the Connections newsletter, please email Fran in the church office at office@gmpc.net or give her a call at 303-985-8733 and leave her a message. We'd love to get that started for you. Please know if you are seeing this recorded worship service prior to 10 a.m. on Sunday morning, we invite you to join us for the Zoom prayer fellowship time, and we look forward to blessing the animals as part of that time together at 10 a.m. on Sunday morning. Thanks again to those of you who participated in our food drive for animals with pet foods and toys that we could take over to Foothills Animal Shelter. They send their deep words of appreciation and thanks to all of you for your generosity toward these precious creatures that dwell there. Friends, know that any Wednesday, you are welcome to join a small group at 9 in the morning or 7 at night via Zoom to look at the scripture texts and the sermon from the Sunday prior to the Wednesday. Please know that the Episcopal Presbyterian small group continues on Zoom on Thursdays at 4 o'clock, and we continue to work our way thoughtfully through Debbie Irving's book, Waking Up White, and we always welcome new participants. Like to highlight for you too that there is a memorial service that will be live streamed, and you can also greet the family via Zoom for our beloved Ricky Morgan a week from today on Sunday, October 18th at 2 o'clock. So again, check your Connections newsletter for those links so that you can be with the family and celebrate Ricky's life. And friends, also please know that in the Connections newsletter, you can find information about the virtual crop walk, which starts on October 16th and continues on into November, a wonderful way for us to be a part of helping those who are hungry in our own community and around the world. And now, friends, may you find that you are dwelling richly on this earth, in this humus, in this place where we find ourselves grounded in the here and now, aware of what you bring and what others bring, that together we might glorify God. May you find that you are more aware as you learn from the creatures that are part of your life how to be present right now so that we can live in deeper and more authentic ways with those around us. Because when we do such, we can make greater impacts in this world for the realm of God. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord be kind and gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you deep and abiding peace, both this day and forevermore. Alleluia. Amen.